us again here. We're in a series called The Principle of the Path. Principle of the Path. And what we're saying is all of us are on a journey that has choices on it, aren't we? That we have opportunities to turn right or turn left. And where we end up will be determined by the turns we make, huh? Isn't it true that sometimes we have, we talked about this the first week, sometimes we have the idea in our minds that if I just believe it, it's going to be different, right? But then we make choices that would go against those things. And our choices actually lead us one way. And all along we're going, I hope this will get better. And we continue to make bad choice after bad choice. And it doesn't matter actually how much we hope for something if our choices don't align with the hope that we have. Isn't that right? It's basic information. And so last week we continued this idea. We continued this concept that we have to make good choices to get where we want to be. And this week, what we're going to do, the last couple weeks, we talked about how sometimes our choices can lead to destruction. In fact, last week's verse, if you remember, was Proverbs chapter 22 and verse 3. It said, the wise see danger and take precaution. But the simpleton, the fool, the one who's stupid, goes on blindly and suffers for it, that we actually have to take action. And if you missed last week, man, it's so important. You stay with us on this series. You can go to roarnewlife.com. It's a sermon video, and you can watch all of that and stay plugged into what's going on. But this week, we're going to talk about, okay, how do we just make good choices? All of us want to be on the path toward God. And not all of our choices are sinful or not sinful. Not all of our choices will end in pain. In fact, many times, I would say the majority of us are probably not in a place where we're making dramatic choices about our life right now. You might not even be in that spot. But if you're like me, I'm not necessarily in that spot where I'm just going, okay, God, I've got this big decision to make. I'm not there right now. But if you're like me, you want to be on a path that leads to God. And we all know that whether we're running or whether we're walking, we are on a path, we're on a journey. This is not something that's stagnant. This is not something that's idle. There is no point in your spiritual life where you can stand still. Do you know that? There is no point at which you can just press pause and go, hang on, I think I'm going to take a break. That's not how spiritual life works. In fact, I sometimes think about my spiritual life and my spiritual journey like I'm on one of those things at the airport. You know what I'm talking about? Those things that kind of propel you forward. You feel like you're running by the person that's going by. You're just walking. But except it's like this. I'm going against it. And so I have to keep stepping in order to make progress or I'll get dragged with the stream of where it's going. And so our spiritual lives are not idle. We can't push pause. So we're in a direction. We're taking steps right now. You are, whether you're aware of it or not. You may be completely unaware of it, but you are taking steps that are either leading you toward God or away from God. And so I don't know about you, but I want to make choices and decisions. I want to end up on the path that God has for me. I would hate to wake up someday and go, man, I've been on the wrong path for so long. In general, I would say this. We want to be people who are on a good path. And so what we've got to do is figure out how to get us consistently every day, even when we're not in one of those big life-altering decision moments, every day, figuring out how to choose the right path. Which I don't know about you, but that can be a little difficult. Have you ever had one of those moments where you have to choose a path, you have to choose a direction, you don't exactly know what to do? I've had those moments. So if you have Bible this morning, I'm going to invite you to turn back to the book of Proverbs. We've been in the Proverbs for the last few weeks, looking at different ideas and different stories and learning how to walk paths that will lead to good places. Proverbs was written by a man whom the Bible says was the wisest man who'd ever lived. The wisest man, King Solomon. He was the son of David, actually the illegitimate son of David. And God raised him up to be king, and he ruled and built the temple and all these wonderful things. And also in the midst of it, in spite of being the wisest man who ever lived, made some ridiculously terrible choices. Isn't that crazy how that works? That you would think if he was the wisest man who's ever lived, that he would never, ever need to really call upon God. He's got it all anyway. God had deposited all that good sense and knowledge and understanding into his heart. Yet, Solomon would stand up here today and say, even with all the wisdom, even with all the understanding, even all the smarts that I've got, I continued to put myself on paths that led toward pain and destruction and hurt. So in many ways, what we're going to learn today is one of those moments where Solomon is saying, do as I say. And we get to watch his life and go, man, I learned that lesson because of how he made wrong choices. So Solomon says, the question we're going to answer today is, how do we know what to do? How do we know God's will? We're going to frame it in a lot of different ways. How do we know how to get on the right path? How do we know how to make the good choice? How do we know what to do even when we don't know what to do? And Solomon would stand here today, if he were to hear, and say, you know what? Even with all my knowledge, even with all my wisdom, here are some things. I cannot rely on my wisdom. Something we know well. In fact, what we're going to read here in just a moment are some of the most familiar verses in the Bible. In fact, I could probably go across this room and you could quote them. You might even have a picture is framed on your wall somewhere at your house. You might have this coffee mug at your house. They're so ingrained. You probably won't even have to continue opening up your Bible because they're so ingrained in your heart. In fact, on the day I was elected to become the pastor of this church, I stood right there, okay? I remember the moment very clearly, and we had just been elected. Our presbyter at the time, Phil Anderson, we were off in the fellowship hall, come got us and said, hey, it's a positive vote, and that was great, you know, because there's nothing more nerve-wracking than having preached a sermon, gone through months of an interview process, and it comes down to that moment, and you're waiting in the other room to be told, did they like you or not? And so it was a positive vote. We're down here, and honestly, I might have had a smile on my face, but in my heart, I was exploding because I was terrified. It's terrified about what to do. In fact, it's that moment of reality. You spend all this energy in the interview process talking about what you think the church would you do if you pastor the church and where you take it. And now that you're there, now they will call you pastor. I remember thinking, I don't know what to do. I don't even know what to preach. Why did they? What were they doing? What were they thinking? And maybe now you're thinking that. What were we thinking? I really was terrified, and I felt like God had called us, and that was confident in my heart. But I didn't know how God was going to do what He was going to do, and really had no idea what the first steps would be. And I just stood there in the altar with a smile on my face, but with panic in my heart. And then this wonderful little woman of God, who's since gone on to be the Lord, made her way to me. And if you've been around New Life for any length of time, you know Grandma Strand very well. And she walked up to me, and she didn't even say hello to me, okay? It wasn't like a greeting, congratulations, any of that stuff that everybody else had said. You know, they're so excited. She walks up to me and she grabs my hand, those little hands, and she looks me in the eye. And if you've ever been looked in the eye by Liz Strand, you know that it's a piercing gaze. And she says to me, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge Him, and He will make your path straight. And it was like the Word of God
was being spoken to me. It was like this little old woman. It was not this little old woman. It was the voice of the Holy Spirit. Because we get in those times in life, in Proverbs, for those of you that may not know, I think it was on the screen behind me, I'm sure, but Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and then he will make your paths straight. So we all face those times when we do not know what to do. We're at that fork in the road, or we're right there before we get there. And maybe you're not even there this morning, but you know you want definitely the promise that's at the end of that verse, that God would make your path straight, that even when you don't know what's happening, that in the process, God would lead you onto the right path. But God has given us a very specific way to know what to do and how to do it. And it starts at the beginning of this verse. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Trust in the Lord with all. Everybody say all. All. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. With all your heart. That means in every arena of life, in every possible path that you'll get on, trust in the Lord. This means leaning hard into not information, not insight, not your own wisdom, not facts, but leaning hard into God himself, into the person of Jesus Christ. Not even what Jesus Christ would say, but into who he is. It means trusting in God. Because the answer to your life and the answer to the situations that you're in at work or the situations you're in at home or in your finances or in your marriage or any other thing that you're going through or any other category where you're making choices, the answer is not more information. It's never more information. The answer to our life is trusting in, leaning hard into God. Which makes sense that he starts here. Solomon shows his wisdom here. In this verse, it makes sense that he starts here because the fundamental question that we ask when we're walking in the paths of life, whether you do this, whether you know this consciously or not, you're asking a question all the time when you're making your choices. It's this: can God be trusted? Can God be trusted? Now, you may never have phrased it that way. You may never have put that question that clearly all the time. But you have asked that many times. Can God be trusted? In the choices we make in life, we're making decisions based upon how much we trust God. Think about it in this context. Think about it in the relationship to the temptations that we face. It's easy to see it there. The temptations that we face are more than about the sin that we might may or may not engage with. Okay, they're bigger than that. Look at the original temptation of man. All the way back in Genesis, beginning of the book. What does the tempter say? What does the enemy say when he starts the whole process? Before they engage in sin, before they get in the whole thing, he says, did God really say? What is the tempter doing? He's subverting the trust they have in God. He's saying, did God really say that? He probably didn't say it that way. He probably didn't mean that. Can God be trusted? I mean, will it really happen that badly? It can't be as big as what he's saying. What the tempter has done, what the enemy has done, and what the enemy will do in your life and what he will do in mine is come along and say, did God really say? I mean, is it that big of a deal? I mean, is he going to really, when you stand before him, isn't he going to be reasonable? Aren't you going to be able to go, well, God, I know the Bible says this is wrong. But, this situation clearly means that I cannot follow that commandment. Because, don't you see the situation demanded that I disobey your command. You understand. Of all people who's going to understand God, you understand God saying, whoa, 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 whoa. That command was not so much about telling you what's right and what's wrong, though when God tells us what's right and what's wrong, it's all about the path.
That command really was about us saying, God, I trust you. Even when I can't see all the outcomes of that trust. Trusting God and being obedient in his instruction can be pretty challenging at times. In fact, it can be downright scary, can't it? We construct outcomes in our mind. We think, God, I trust you. And then we use a word that negates everything that came before that sentence. I trust you, but... Guess what? If you include a but in the sentence, you don't trust him. You don't. You can say whatever you want. God, I trust you, period. That's what's supposed to stop there. See, what's really hard is we come up with all these scenarios in our mind, and this is part of the work of the enemy and part of the work of our imagination. So we think, God, if I follow what you want me to do, I know what you want me to do right now. I know the path you want me to take. But this is what's going to happen if that path plays out. I'm going to break that relationship. I'm going to be in this difficult situation. I'm going to have to see one of the people I love hurt and suffer. And if I do that, the consequence, it's not good. And God's standing there going, But God, don't you see what will happen next? As if we can see the future and he can't. God, don't you see what will happen next? God's saying, don't you trust me with the outcomes? Don't you trust that I'm big? Don't you trust that if you are obedient to me, that if you listen to me, that you make the right choice, that I'm going to figure it out? Don't you trust me? See, it all begins on trust. And when we don't trust God, when we sin, or when we say no to God's path, we say no to God's choice, we say no, we'll never inherit the promise of this verse. We'll never inherit it because everything, your relationship with God, all hinges upon trust. And God would say, don't you trust me? But here's the hard part of trust. Trust is not demonstrated by our emotions. Trust is not demonstrated by our words. Trust is demonstrated by our actions. So, we've got this ladder at the church. Okay. I call it the Widowmaker. It's an old wooden ladder, okay? We still got it somewhere. I was going to pull up on stage today almost. If I was to put, we bought a new ladder because this thing is just scary. I mean, it's just at any moment, you just like it, it's going to collapse, you know, right? If I was to put both ladders on this stage, I put the new fiberglass ladder, and if I was to put this old wooden ladder, which one would you trust? Of course, you put the fiberglass ladder, and how do you demonstrate that you trust the ladder? Not by looking at it and saying, that's probably a good ladder. That's not how we demonstrate trust, is it? We demonstrate trust by climbing the ladder, by putting our weight in the ladder, by literally not keeping one foot on the ground and kind of making sure you hedge your bets. No, you don't do any of that. You actually put all of your life onto the ladder. You demonstrate trust by action, by what you do, not what you say, not even what you feel in your heart. You demonstrate trust by action. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Solomon goes on to say this, trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not lean on your own understanding. Do not lean on your own understanding. This comes from a little Hebrew phrase that literally means to prop something up against. Prop something up against. Don't lean on your own understanding. Don't prop yourself up against your own understanding. Basically, your tendency and mine, with the decisions and the choices we make. Usually, we make those decisions and choices based on what we know and what we've seen in the world and what we've experienced in the world. Here's how it goes often in our conversations. And men, I hate to say, but we're probably the worst about this. Okay, so we hear of a situation. Maybe we're talking with a friend. We hear of a situation, and we go, you know what I do in that situation? You know what I do? You know what I've done before there? Some of you, I just saw an elbow go to a spouse, okay? I know what I, you know, in this situation, we really, you know, when I did that, it was, you know, we did this. And maybe you don't even know what you're talking about, but you go, you know what I do? Probably, you know, and you start jabbering on with basically nonsense, you know? You know what I do? You insert your brilliant idea there. Our tendency is to lean hard on our own knowledge and our own experience and our own understanding to prop ourselves up in that arena. And now that's not to say, let me just pause. It's not to say we shouldn't grow in knowledge. Not to say we shouldn't grow in wisdom. Not to say we shouldn't grow in understanding and read books and do all. That's not saying this is wrong. In fact, that's a very right thing to do. But Solomon realizes something really important. He's the wisest man, the Bible says, to have ever lived. And he's realizing that his understanding, that our understanding is not strong enough to hold the weight of our decisions. That if we prop our decisions up on our understanding does not have the strength to hold them up. That we will fall and we will fail. Because you're not smart enough, your friends aren't smart enough, their friends aren't smart enough to make the right choices that you need to make in your life. Don't prop your decisions up on your own understanding. No matter how smart we are, no matter how wise we get, there will always be a bend in the path that will outrank our knowledge. I want to say that again. No matter how smart we are, and no matter how wise we get, there will always be a bend in the path that will outrank our knowledge. And the good news this morning, is that we can trust God and His understanding. We start with the person and then we move to His wisdom. And I can assure you, there has never been a situation where God has been stumped. You know what God has never said? Let me think about that. God's never said that. He's never said, We say that. God always knows what to do. God always understands what the situation's about. He sees the beginning. He sees the middle. He sees the end. He knows everything. We can trust on His understanding. We can lean upon it. If you want to get on the right path with God, it starts with moving your trust from yourself or the things you can do to place your trust in God, to God. If you want to know what direction you're supposed to take, listen to the wisest man who'd ever lived. He says, look, I'm going to put it in a different way. Direction doesn't begin with direction. Direction does not begin with direction. We don't start by finding out the right path by saying, God, what is the right path? That's not where we start. Direction begins with submission. Direction begins with submission. Did you catch that? Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. The first two parts of that verse have nothing to do with direction. Where do I need to go? They have everything to do with submission. So submission then precedes direction. Submission, surrender, precedes where we're going to go. We are so quick to pray, God, what am I supposed to do? The better prayer might be, God, where are you? Begin by trusting in the Lord with all your heart, leaning not on your understanding. Before you get to the forks in the road, before you have only a few options to choose from. You decide today, God, I'm going to trust you right now. Even when I don't necessarily have choices to make. God, I'm going to trust you no matter what I perceive the consequences of that trust to be. God, every decision I make today will be a reflection of the trust I already have in my heart. So Solomon continues. He says, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. And he says this, in all your ways, acknowledge him. It's like as if we're not getting the point by this go-around. He just recircles back. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. And listen, let's go back to that first thing. In all your ways, acknowledge him. Acknowledge him. In all. There is no wiggle room in that word, is there? Man, God doesn't give us a loophole in this. He doesn't say, in all your ways except for your kids. Oh, your kids, you don't have to acknowledge God with your kids. Just do whatever you want. No. That means in your marriage ways, in your entertainment ways, in your finance ways, in your parenting ways, in your dating ways, in your morality ways, your political ways, your communication ways, your education ways, and your professional. Am I missing the category? I'm sure I am. But in every way, in every path, in all your ways, not just your Sunday ways or your religious ways, in all your ways, in all your paths, in all the different avenues and arenas of your life, acknowledge God. The question that began to ring in my heart with this, and it really was, just, it hung there, was God began to ask this question to me, in all your ways acknowledge, do the decisions of my day, not in the big moments, but in every moment, do the decisions that I make acknowledge God? Or bring credit to God. Or bring honor to God. Every decision. God says, in all your ways. In your interactions at work. In the conversations you have. In the jokes that you tell. In everything. In all your ways. Would that be something where people would go, oh, I can point that to God. Man, that question really got into my heart this week. In all my ways. Every decision I make, every attitude I have, every word that I say, it does acknowledge that God, I trust him and that he's in my life. Whew. That one's hard, isn't it? We like to quote this verse, don't we? Maybe we haven't stopped and really chewed on it. In all my ways means that we'll learn to live a life with a God component in every single avenue. Not just God in my relationships and my finances and my kids and my your grandkids and all grandkids. But you invite God into every choice you make. Did you know, if you're a salesperson here today, you can stop before you go to sell something and you say, God, I need your help. I need your help to make this sale. I need your help to say the right things because my family depends on this. So God, I need your help. In all my ways, I'm going to acknowledge you. That's how it works. God, I'm getting ready to go into a dinner tonight with a couple, and I just love this couple. God, may tonight, may I acknowledge you with what I say and what I do and how I treat them. May I acknowledge you. I've just infused God into every choice and every decision, every situation that I've made. In all my ways, acknowledge him. And here's the promise. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him. And here's the great promise. Then, he will make your paths straight. He will make your paths straight. This phrase, we don't use this phrase like it's used in the Bible. In fact, this phrase is used all over the Bible. If you remember John the Baptist, he said, make straight the way of the Lord. This is the same phrase, the same idea. That literally, in the Hebrew understanding, in this worldview, this little phrase means that God will make the way clear. One commentator would put it this way, that God would fill all of the potholes in the road. That he will make the way plain. In our terminology, we would say it like this, we will know what path to take. Because submission precedes direction. When we've done all of those things, we trusted in God, and we've leaned not on our understanding, and we've acknowledged him in every corner of our life, our submitted life to him, and then God will provide us the direction that we need. We'll know what path to take. We'll know what choice to make. And it can be so heartbreaking. We've talked about this over the weeks, to hear people share stories where they're reaping the consequences of choices and decisions they've made. Those times we can listen to their story, and what we can clearly see is where they went wrong. And, and we can hear that, and we go, I can tell you, it was 4 years ago when you met, that's where you started. And that the pushback could easily be what? Well, yeah, you can see it now. Hindsight's what? 2020. The past is clear. Exactly. And that's why God is so adamant that we trust him first. Because God, guess what, can see the future. The future is 2020 to him. Past is 2020 for us. But God says, listen, trust me first. Don't trust you first. You can't see the future. You can't really, even all the ideas that you have about how it will go, you don't know that's how it will go. You don't know that there's another factor that you haven't seen, or I see everything. I have that vantage point. Trust in me. Would you please let me be the one who decides your situations? Would you please just submit? Even when it's not easy. And acknowledge me when there's no pressure, so that when the road gets harder and the decisions get a little less clear to see and understand, you've developed the habit of trusting me. You don't need more information for the decisions you make in life. You don't. We need more submission. We don't simply need more insight, more clarity, more understanding, because most of the time we're going to have everything that we need in our hands, right? What we need is more surrender to who God is. We've all had those moments in life where we were given great advice or great information and we ignored it. So more information is not necessarily going to help us. But when we wake up every day, we begin that day with a decision. Because the decision to trust God, the decision to trust God is not something we go, set it and forget it. Oh, I got it. My trust button is pushed. Let's go. That's not how it works, is it? It's me every morning and many times, several times during the day, going, God, God, I'm going to trust you. I'm going to act in a way that I trust you. I'm going to actually trust you. I'm going to put all my weight on. I'm going to climb your ladder here, hoping that it ends in a good spot. I'm going to trust you, God. And God's saying, just trust me. Trust me. Acknowledge me. Put your thoughts into me. You know, I was thinking about this week. When I follow someone, let's say I don't know where I'm going and I'm following a person in a car. Okay, so I'm behind them in my car and then follow. I get pretty neurotic about this, especially if I'm on a highway. Maybe you're not like me, maybe you are, I don't know. But if I am following somebody, I don't know where to go. Even if there's hundreds of miles left in the journey, I try to be right on that person. I don't even like one or two cars between us. Even though I can see their car, I don't like it. I want to be right behind that other person. I want to be right there. And when I'm actually leading someone somewhere, that stresses me out when they allow space. Okay? And they allow space. How many times? Because the more space I have put between me and that car that I'm following, the more cars I allow to get between me, the more opportunity there is a red light, or they make a turn that I didn't see. And now I've got to trust my own understanding and my own knowledge, which is what? Nothing. I don't know where I'm going. And see, here's where we fool ourselves. We think we know where we're going in our life. We think we know. We think we know. I can tell you right now, even though God's done a great miracle
and great work. Chuck did not anticipate being in a hospital bed this week. He did not anticipate that. He's cool. He's fine. God's really doing a great work, and he'll share the testimony with you after service and ask him about it. He wants to tell you. So we don't know. We think we know. We fool ourselves into thinking we know. And here's the deal. We find ourselves praying and praying and praying. Jonathan, you can come. Find ourselves praying and praying and praying and praying and praying. Say, God, what's the direction for my life? Where am I going? What decisions should I make? What choices should I make? Where should I go? What should I do? And God is saying, wait, don't worry. I've got the direction. Just stay close to me. Because if you stay close to him, you'll never have to worry about what turn he's going to make. Because he'll always lead you in the right place, won't he? God will always, always, always lead you into the right spot. And so the closer you are to him, the closer you are, the better off you'll be. The more you trust him, the more you just don't let any cars get between you and him. You're just going to be right there, because if he makes a turn, you're going to make a turn. You don't have to worry. It's when we get that distance. It's when we focus on where we're going, and we're sitting there going, oh, man, why didn't he make that turn? Why didn't he make that turn? When we focus on all those other things, we miss where God might be taking us. It starts with trusting in God, leaning not on our own understanding, our own knowledge, and our own wisdom. All our ways acknowledging him. If we just get that, we literally do not have to worry. But I can promise you this. If you don't trust God in every decision, and the decisions that matter for you, when you talk about your kids, when you talk about your marriage, if you don't make that first step where I'm gonna trust God here. And I'm not gonna lean on my own understanding here. I'm not gonna trust myself. I'm gonna acknowledge God. If you don't take those steps, you will never, never find yourself in a spot where the path is clear. It will always be like, oh, constant chaos. Constant chaos. Because you didn't start with trust. And I'm not saying that every problem in the world, the Bible says it rains on the just and the unjust alike, okay? But many times, the Bible also says that we reap what we sow. So if you're in constant chaos, we might take a journey back in our life and look at the chaos that we might have sown to be what we're reaping, right? Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him. And then the promise of God, which means that if you've been doing those things and it looks like God's not there, let me be the herald for God this morning. God is on his way. He is making the path clear, even though you might not be able to see it. Stand confident today that if you've trusted God and you go, yep, I've done that, and I've not leaned on my own understanding, and I have acknowledged God, I've had all those moments where I've stopped and said, God, I need you to help me here. If you've done that, let me be the bearer of great news this morning. God is going to make your path straight. You can be encouraged today. I want you to stand with me this morning. Jonathan's going to lead us in a song. And then we're going to come back and we're going to close our time in prayer and response. But I want to sing this song first. Jonathan, would you lead us?